Thank you for joining me again on the program Harvest Feast. Thank you. God bless you. It's always good to have you here to explore the Word of God together and to grow together as believers and also to shine the light of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ to those who are still outside the gate. For the Bible says, enter by the narrow gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way that leads to life. And there are few who find it. Underscore that one. Few will find it, they have to find it. That makes the whole difference. People going on the Broadway, they don't have to find it. It looks and appears so natural, and people just continue to walk on it. And I pray this day, if you have found the narrow way, that you keep walking on that narrow way in Jesus' name. Now today, we are going to a whole new different sermon by the grace of God. But before we go ahead, let's have a word of prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you. Father, we bless you. For indeed, this is the day you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in this day. Thank you for making it possible again for this program to be here this day. And thank you for the souls that you will touch, especially those that have been deceived by the lies of the enemy. Father, I pray that you will turn their situation around this day. And for those who already know you, Father, I pray they will get to know you more, even when they have listened to this sermon. And together, we will all be better off as your children. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Today's Bible reading, the sermon for today has its Bible reading from the book of Galatians. That is Galatians chapter 3. I'll start from verse 19 and stop at 25. That's Galatians chapter 3, starting from verse 19 to 25. What purpose then? The Lord serve. It was added because of transgressions, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made. And it was appointed through angels by the hand of a mediator. Now a mediator does not mediate for one only, but God is one. Is the law then against the promises of God? Certainly not. For if there had been a law given, which could have given life, truly righteousness would have been by the law. But the scriptures has confined all under sin, that the promise by faith in Jesus might be given to those who believe. But before faith came, we were kept under guard by the law, kept for the faith which would afterward be revealed. Therefore, the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Today's sermon is simply titled, Human Goodness Without Christ, a Recipe for Hellfire. Human goodness without Christ, a recipe for hellfire. Going by the passage I just read, if you are listening to me very well, you understand it's talking about the law that was given through the hands of Moses. Now, people have taken the law. When we say the law, it's talking about obeying the law, following the law, which is by every means. The law, obeying the law, is what we should do. But when we obey the law, where do we put our hearts? Where do we put our trust? This is what we are talking about. It's not just obeying the law, but obeying the law and not putting your trust in the law, that you are able to do things by yourself. This is the core of this message today. When you obey the law, when you follow the law so that you can honor God, are you thinking you are able to do things on your own, or you have your trust in God who is able to save you? As I go further, I will shed more light on this very topic. Remember, it's titled Human Goodness Without Christ, a Recipe for Hellfire. Now, let me quickly give a background to this Bible passage so that we understand the whole concept. This Bible passage was part of the letter written to Christians in the Gaul area, which included not just one town. That's why it's called Galatians. People who live in that area, it included three or four big towns like Antioch, Iconium, Lystra, and Derbe. All these towns, they were part of the area called the Gaul area, and they were referred to as Galatians. Now, that given that background, the Christians there, they were invaded, if I can use that word, by the people you can call legalists. Judaizers, they were called. They came into the church, or they were part of the church already, and then they asserted that non-Jews believers had to be circumcised for their salvation to be complete. They opined that Paul's teaching, talking about Apostle Paul, that his teachings were inferior in that it spoke lies of the observance of the law. What they wanted, talking about these Judaizers, the people that we regard to here as the legalists, they wanted a situation whereby the focus will be on the law given to Moses rather than having faith in Jesus as preached by Paul the Apostle. Now, there are problems with this situation from all these, legalists. If you listen to me carefully, you understand the problem they had. They did not only believe in the law of Moses, they believed something different, sinister. What they believed in was to draw the heart of man to man himself, to make man his own God, so that man can think, once I'm able to achieve it on my own, then I'm made. That was the whole idea. So it was a case of starting another religion, if you will. Now, let me go on by saying that there are two types of religions in the old world, two major types of religions: the true religion and false religion. But you know the one they wanted to start? They wanted to start a false religion in the Church of God. Now, the true religion, what's the difference between the true religion and the false religion? The true religion preaches sinful nature of human beings. It preaches how sinful we are as human beings, and it emphasizes that sinfulness in relation to the helplessness of man to save himself. And it points directly to a savior. It presents a savior in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the true religion. Now, I haven't defined the true religion. You want to hear the definition of A false religion emphasizes human's capability of making themselves righteous before God by their good works. The false religions do not emphasize the holiness of God or the degeneracy of sinfulness of man. The false religion will never place emphasis on the sinfulness of man. The false religion will emphasize all the time the nature of human being, the goodness that can be found in human being, and how people can do things. They will tell you are good and dandy. You can go all the way. You can achieve all you think you can achieve. Nobody is saying you cannot achieve it. Don't get me wrong. But your trust has to be in the Savior, not in your own ability. That is what we are seeing here. In essence, they appeal to the very thing that made man fall in the very first place. Disobedience that stems from unfaithfulness. So what Apostle Paul was trying to address here was to quench the ugly head of false religion from springing up among believers. That's all he wanted to do. And by the grace of God, he wrote the letter, the epistle, we now call Galatians, and this portion of the Bible is actually addressing the case of this legalist trying to make people who are circumcised only as true believers. The Bible says why we need to be very careful to understand the word of God. You cannot put your trust in your ability or what you can do. Whatever you can do, God be praised for it, but never put your trust in what you think you can do, because it will lead definitely to one thing. It will lead to colossal failure. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, say, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths. That's the word of God. That is the word of God. Now, let's go into that Bible passage proper so that we can examine exactly what this Bible passage is saying. Remember, this sermon is titled Goodness Without Christ is a Recipe for Hellfire. So let's go into that Bible passage. The very first part is talking about the law being given through Moses to let people see their boundaries as it's related to breaking God's rules until the promised Messiah came, talking about Jesus. God's standards are to be kept, for God is holy. People need to realize that there should be standards, there should be things that they can do and things they cannot do. You don't want to leave human beings to roam and make decisions just anyhow. That was why God gave the law. So we don't want to confuse it as God giving the law so that man could be saved. It was never meant for that purpose. It was meant so that people will be held accountable for their transgression. And now that God was setting them up, God did one thing, so that when they could see their inability to fulfill the laws, obeying the laws based on his standard, then that will make them look up to God, and they will know that God is there, and they will say, God, we need your help. That's the whole essence. That's the whole essence of giving the law. And the Bible says in Leviticus 20, 26, talking about the holiness of God, the Bible says, and you shall be holy to me, for I, the Lord, I am holy, and I've separated you from the peoples that you should be mine. So God will not be looking on seeing people just breaking the laws without being shown the right way. We know God is righteous all the time. The law was not given so as to replace the promise made to save mankind. Now, far from it, the Lord was incapable of saving man because of man's ineptitude, man's inability to fulfill the law and be justified by it. God did not give the law to save mankind. I said that before. God did not do that in replacement for the promise he made. He never did that. He never did that. He never said that. To replace it with the promise he made through Abraham, God never said that. God already established believing by faith through Abraham. Abraham believed God, the Bible says, and it was accounted for him for righteousness. So Abraham believed God. He believed God is who he is. He believed God would do what he says he would do, and it was accounted for him for righteousness. So Abraham did not believe just by doing things that would make him righteous before God. The Bible says in Romans chapter 4, verses 23 and 24, that and he, Abraham, believed. No, this is Genesis 15. I'm sorry, verse 6. And he, Abraham, believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for righteousness. That is the word of God. Romans chapter 4, verses 23 and 24 say, now it was not written for his sake alone, that is, it was not written for his sake alone, it was imputed to him, but also for us, it shall be imputed to us who believe in him, that is talking about God, who raised up Jesus our Lord from the dead. What the Bible is saying is, as Abraham believed God, that God is who he says he is, and God can do what he says he can do, same thing still holds for you and I today, that when we believe God, God will account that for us for righteousness, when we believe through his only begotten Son, because now we have faith has come to us. Jesus has come. He has died for our sin. He has risen up. Now we have faith. We cannot say where is faith again. So we have better testimony. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, going further, the giving of the law brought about the understanding of sin. A man is incapable of fulfilling this law. We know that for his justification. Now, man is bound with sin and can only be set free by having faith in Jesus for his own justification. You see, the Bible says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Wait for that. Let's look at it from the book of Titus. See what the Bible says. The Bible says, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, both Jews and Gentiles, who were originally far away from God. The Bible says they were put on a level ground of being made righteous through faith in Jesus Christ alone. For neither the law nor the observance of the law or the observance of circumcision had the ability to deliver man from the grip of sin and death. That was exactly what Apostle Paul was saying to them. That don't fool yourself. He wasn't condemning them obeying the law. That's not what he was saying. All he was saying was, don't make any mistake of putting your trust in observing the law. He was saying to them that when you observe the law, let the law point you to God so that your faith, your trust, your belief will be in God alone. That was Apostle Paul's argument. The law was useful in that it pointed man to his need of a Savior through whom he can be justified by placing his faith in him. And therefore, The law was relevant as a pointer only before Jesus Christ came. When Jesus' time has come, we did not and we do not need the law as a pointer anymore. And we all know this, that as we are today, we are not saved by the works of our hands. So we need to bear that in mind all the time, that Jesus has done it all for us. Romans chapter 3, verses 23 to 25 says, Let me just go ahead before I read the Bible passage. God made the law and gave it through the hand of Moses to abate the transgression. This is not reading Bible. The transgression of man, so that he would not face God's wrath. Talking about man, not to face God's wrath. That's why God gave the law. So that man will have warning. So that man will not continue to sin. Man will not continue in his transgression. Remember, man was full of sinfulness, and God had to abate that so that something will help man to look up to God. That was the purpose of law. I've spent too much time on that simply because I wanted to be sure that we have a good background. We have a good background about what I'm talking about. That law, that is the observance of law. Observing law has no ability to save anybody. And that is what people call being good. You will hear from time to time, he's a good person. I'm not against calling somebody a good person. If that's how you feel, God be praised for that. All I'm saying is, based upon the authority of the Word of God, no one is good before God. No one is good before God. That's the truth. We all need a Savior. And God has made a provision for us. So let me go ahead and talk about the personal application of this Bible passage. Because as you are listening to me, I know you will have some questions you want to ask. And I can tell you from my humble experience, most of those questions, in a way, some of them might be provocative. And some of them might be just, you know, simple. But I have a couple of questions here that I know you might be thinking of asking me. Should you have the opportunity to talk or ask Pastor John a question? You may want to ask Pastor John. Now, how were the Old Testament saints saved if they did not put their trust in the works? That is, in the obedience of the law and the rituals and everything that was given to them to do. The simple answer is they were saved simply by putting their trust in God, which is equivalent to having faith in Jesus for the New Testament believers. Period. Simple. They were saved by putting their faith in God. The Bible says Abraham believed God. Remember, Jesus had not come when Abraham believed God. And the Bible says it was accounted unto righteousness for Abraham. And the Bible for that says, not only for Abraham, for all of us that will also have faith, it will be accounted for righteousness for us, as we have faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. So I hope that will answer that first question, because there is no other way, the Bible says, we can be saved except to put our trust in Jesus. Amen? Amen. Now, the laws made them see their inability. I explained that one the other time. The laws made the Old Testament sin. He made them to see their inability to save themselves. God used the law to point them to him. And they put their trust in God. That's how they got saved. Amen. Amen. But the Bible says in Romans chapter 4 verse 3, for what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Always remember that. God is looking at your heart. Nothing else. Your faith in God is what God is after. Now we have a good and much better dispensation. God has provided his only begotten son for us, the Lord Jesus Christ. Having faith in him, you'll be saved. That's what the Bible says. So I don't think that should be confused with any other thing at all, unless we want to follow our own way. And I pray you will not follow your own way this day in the name of Jesus. Amen. I read also from Romans chapter 4, verse 16. The Bible says, therefore, It is of faith that it might be according to grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. He became father of us all by having faith in God. So for everyone that has faith in God through Jesus Christ, such a person has become a child or a descendant of Father Abraham. That is the way it works. In Jesus' name, you will not miss out on your salvation. That's my prayer for you. Amen. Amen. Now, this is something you can simply conclude, that the father of many nations that God promised to make Abraham actually are the believers from different tribes and tongues that will be reconciled to God by his grace through faith. That's what the Bible says. That promise of father of many nations that God said I will make Abraham, God was referring because God could see so many people that will be reconciled through the faith he established through Abraham. That people that will have faith in the like manner, they will be reconciled back to him. So God saw that and God said to him, I will make you father of many nations. Reading Revelation chapter 5 verse 9, it explains it. It says, and they sang a new song. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seal. For you were slain, talking about the Lord Jesus that died for us all, and he rose again for our salvation. You were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation. Do you see Abraham being the father of many nations? That's what the Bible is saying there. So in a conclusion, small conclusion in that area, the common denominator of both Old Testament saints and New Testament believers is faith in God. That is, trusting God to be who he says he is and believing him to do what he says he will do. That is the kind of faith the scripture says Abraham had. And that is the kind of faith we need to have. Amen. Don't be deceived. Now, you may want to ask another question. All right, Pastor John, I think I understand that reasonably. I might have to research the scripture more to understand what you're saying. So what happens to good works? What exactly happened to good works? To be honest with you, scripturally speaking, there's a difference between human charity works and Christian good works. So I just want to lay that foundation so you understand. For the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. So good works for Christians are their good deeds through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. They are not done for publicity, they are not done for show. That is done through the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. They are acceptable before God as good works because they are not done in the flesh, but in the imputed righteousness of Jesus. Do you see the difference? In short, no good works can be done through soiled hands of sinfulness. That is telling you, no man or a woman who has not made Jesus their Lord and Savior can claim that they are doing any good works, because it's not going to be acceptable before a holy God. That's all I'm saying to you. I'm not rubbishing good works. I'm not saying that at all. For we are his workmanship, the Bible says, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. So the summary of it all is, we are not saved by good works, but we are saved unto good works. I'll say that again because some people might not get it. As I've been saying, that no good works we have in ourselves that can save anybody. The Bible makes it clear that we are not saved by good works, but we are saved unto good works. That's what you can see in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. So just get it clear in your heart that, you know, when you talk about people doing good works, well, good works is just good works as the people in the world may want to define it to be. But when it comes to the standard of a holy God, you don't want to bring that before God, okay? Now, rewards for works done in the flesh are usually received here on earth because they are usually done with spiritually faulty motives and not acceptable to a holy God, before whom all things are naked. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 13, and there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. So I'm saying to you that a degenerate soul, a sinful soul, cannot do an acceptable work before a holy God unless he or she is justified by the blood of Jesus. So if you want to make your good works acceptable before God, you have to come under the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what the Bible says. And I'm not saying your good work that you have been doing, that you can't receive anything for it. No, that's not what I'm saying. Definitely nobody would discourage good works, because you don't want to go ahead and be doing evil. For there is no goodness that can come from doing evil. So let me be honest with you. Good works, even before you become a child of God, is encouraged. It's just that when you are doing that good work outside the gate, it cannot be presented before God for any reward. The rewards are bound here on earth. When you have done good work, people will repay you. There are people that will come back to you for what you have done for them, how you have helped them. They will repay you. It's just that before that good work can be acceptable, before for God to consider it a good work before him, you have to come through the blood of Jesus. That's the only thing I'm saying. So you may want to say, Pastor John, are you saying it's not good to do good? That's not what I'm saying. I've not said that. If you are back on doing evil, I'm telling you, you are doomed. Because the Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 13, but it will not be well with the wicked, nor will he prolong his days, which are as shadow, because he does not fear God. The evil people, they don't fear God. Now the Bible says their way is hard. The way of the transgressors is hard. That's what the Bible says. And the Bible says the evil people going about doing evil, they will not prosper. So you know that. So you don't want to say, oh, because somebody told me. Now, if I'm not a child of God, even anything I do, there's no reward for it. That's not what I've said. I'm talking about the reward in heaven. You receive your reward here on earth. But once you come under the blood of Jesus, you become a child of God, then the whole thing changes. It becomes a different ballgame, like people will say. It is good to do good. At least people will pay you. All I'm saying is, an imperfect person cannot do any good before a holy God, except it is drawn through a holy platform. You know what? Jesus is the holy platform. So, in rounding up my sermon, I want you to know that good people without Jesus will go to hell. Good people without Jesus will go to hell. Are you counting on your own goodness or righteousness to save you? Are you thinking by being good, like some people have been telling you are good? I'm not disputing that. But all I'm saying is there is no goodness in anybody that can save any person. All the goodness in all human beings put together, put in a bottle, like a man of God said, all the goodness in all of us put together cannot save a single soul. So I want you to think about that. Think about that. So you don't get confused and be thinking because people are telling you that you are good, then you are good for heaven. Unfortunately, that is not the case. Therefore, the Bible says, quoting Romans chapter 3, verse 20, therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight. That is the word of God. For the law is the knowledge of sin. That is what the Bible says. Romans chapter 10 verse 4 says, in closing, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. I don't need to begin to spell it A, B, C, D. This is so clear enough. All I've said to you today is don't be deceived. People tell you are good. I'm not disputing you are good. If you are good, you are good. God be praised for that. All I'm saying to you is your goodness cannot take you to heaven. God has made a provision for you. And the provision is found only in Christ Jesus. I want you to consider your way today. Don't you ever try to believe so much in what you know. For remember, this is God's universe. He makes the rules. He judges the offenders and blesses those who obey. And he is always just. I'm saying that to you. He makes all the rules. This is his own universe. Before you can begin to tell God what to do, you have to go into mode of creating your own universe. And if that's possible for you, be my guest. But what I'm saying is, he makes the rule. He makes all the rules. You better just obey his rule. And his rules are very easy. Just follow what he's saying to you, because he's going to judge all the offenders. But those who obey, he rewards them. That's God, because he's always just. I pray this day that you will let the blessings of Abraham be your portion by receiving Jesus Christ into your life. And if you want to do that today, I will encourage you, even as I'm praying now, a link is coming up. It will take you to a page. Want to know Jesus? We have itemized the steps here. Very simple. But we always direct people to that page because it's the most important decision in life anybody can make. So we want you to see the process and the meaning of the decision you are making. And I believe as you do that, God Almighty will meet you here. Amen. Let us pray. Father Lord, we thank you. We bless you for your word that has come forth. Thank you, Lord, that you have opened the heart of people to know that nothing in them is capable of saving them. For the Bible says, there is no salvation in any other except in Jesus. No other name given among men under heaven can save any other person, can save a single soul, except the name of Jesus Christ. Father, I pray this day, as these people have heard your word, Father, I pray it will mix with faith in their hearts and they will make the right decision to come back home to you. Thank you, my Lord and my Savior. Blessed be your holy name. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. And I will see you next time on this program. Until then, remain blessed.